there were a few contained provocations there that were great. We'll pick those up in the discussion. This is a bit of a transition now, because I think and Tim has set us up well for this. So we've kind of moved from the what needs to be done, where are people posturing, what is the progress that's been made, the what and the need, to where it, the rubber hits the road is tends to be in the how. How do things actually get done in complicated systems? And our next speaker is very well positioned to talk about that. After her educational start first in the Netherlands and from there to UC Berkeley, which I don't exactly understand, but I'm looking forward afterwards to figuring out what that connection is. Tisna spent some 30 years working on the ground on a range of programs. So malaria, tuberculosis, AIDS, maternal and child health, the broader aspects of program, much of that in Africa, some 10 years of that in Burkina Faso and Niger, and working on the systems development, the quality improvement, the linkages between public health and clinical care that are required in that, in terms of dealing with complex situations or complex challenges in resource-limited settings. She's now the vice president of URC, which I'll say a little bit more about later, and for their international development group. And
thank you. Thanks. I'm also going to stand up because I think it's easy to talk that way, and I can see you better if I like. Well, Tim and John, both of you have provided lovely segues into the presentation that I wanted to do, which is indeed all these very comprehensive donor programs are well thought through, and they're complex. The guidelines that groups like UNICEF and WHO help develop are evidence-based, and they're even more complex, and they're very, very technical for those who are nutrition, for those of you who are really grounded in nutrition, and those of you who are trying to make sense of nutritional guidelines and make it happen on the ground. What does that really mean? And I want to talk about the program in Uganda that Tim alluded to, but before that, let me just say a little bit about URC's work in general and how that relates to our work in nutrition. I see a lot of familiar faces, so I know that a lot of you know who we are and the kind of work that we've done. We have a long history of working on health system strengthening and looking at how we can actually parcel out systems and take the evidence and help the evidence be the guidelines for how we improve subsystems so that overall outcomes, whether they are in TB and malaria and maternal health or integrated family health programs, lead to the results that we all hope for. Nutrition is sort of a stepchild for many of it, and most policymakers don't view nutrition as meriting the same attention as some of the other vertical programs. And I think that John talked about that, linking nutrition to maternal health, to family planning, and to environmental health. It's a good indication that it's not so easy to get policymakers, let alone policymakers from a broad swath of stakeholders, around the table and agree on something. So what is needed is evidence, and I think that is where URC really has cast a path forward, taking some of the nutritional evidence guidelines and seeing how we can make this happen on the ground, whether it's in HIV/AIDS and OBC programs at the clinical level, but also at the community level, and particularly at the back and forth between communities and facilities, but also in MSCH. And gratifying to hear reference to Guatemala, because URC works in Guatemala in nutrition, and the chronic malnutrition is an intractable problem that USAID is, thank goodness, continuing to put a lot of resources and energy behind. Growth monitoring, conditional fat transfers, and a range of other now linking to more multi-sectoral sustainable livelihood programs are at the core of what USAID and others are doing there. URC is also involved in implementation research. nutrition. So just to give you a flavor. But let me talk a little bit about the NuLife project, because that is what it's called, or was called, rather. The project ended in the summer of this year, after 3.5 years of being in operation. It was, I believe, and Tim, correct me if I'm wrong, one of the first comprehensive programs to try to link policy, operational realization at the service delivery and community level, and RUTF production. The mandate of this particular program was to establish a local production capacity in the state, which I'll tell you a little bit more about because we did that. But it really tries to encapsulate those three cornerstones, the evidence, the latest policy guidelines. How do you make this work at the clinic and the community level? How do you actually get next integrated? And how do you make sure that there is locally produced food available when it is needed and where it is needed? None of these are easy processes to work on. All of it is very doable. I wanted to give you a summary of the main three areas, the policy and job-based work, service delivery, and the production. And if you want to know more about the project, there is a number of materials, including the final report, which has a lot more data than I can present in this short presentation today. But I wanted to give you a sort of a roadmap, if you will. You can see here the covers of both some of the policies that we worked on, some of the training curricula that we worked on, and some of the job aids, all of them having the same images. And that, of course, was intentional. Working in policy level with governments is complicated because even within a single government, there's many stakeholders and many different divisions that have something to say about integrated management of acute malnutrition, community management of acute malnutrition, supply chain, monitoring and evaluation, and how you actually transfer some of these new guidelines to healthcare providers. So there's a lot of negotiation and advocacy, bringing in some external experts from other donors, such as UNICEF. We work very closely in Uganda with UNICEF. Critically important, job aids are, I don't know if many of you all know job aids are both the things that we sometimes all need to remind ourselves of complex tasks, and it is also used oftentimes as counseling materials and take-home materials for clients, but also ensuring that healthcare providers, as they are repeating the same message over and over again, and as that message is scaled up to other facilities, that there is consistency of content. Very important. Service delivery. How do we do it? Because it's one thing to have the guidelines. Tim mentioned it is another thing to train people and make sure they have the latest evidence. It doesn't actually make it happen. We all know that. If you go to, I go to workshops or trainings and I learn something new and I come back to work and I thought that was really interesting. And then I go and I open my email and I get swept up in my daily routine and I kind of forget about it. Or I don't forget about it, but it's really hard to change my habits. It is hard to change. It is even harder to change within facilities where there is relatively few staff, limited resources, and an overload of demand. So URC has brought to the NuLife project the science, if you will, the know-how of how do you introduce quality improvement and what does that, how does that help people who are at the front line of care. This slide is an adaptation of a slide that some of you have seen before. It's a slide that represents the process of improvement together with a number of stakeholders, health facilities, or districts. So what we've done is we brought together groups of facilities. In Uganda, we ended up working with a total of 54 sites, and we brought their supervisors and their regional directors together and said, okay, now we have these new guidelines. Let's make sure that we have everybody trained to make sure that they know what those new guidelines are, and that they do a assessment of the facilities and make sure that the weighing scales are there, that the new arcades are in place, that the counseling materials are in place, and that there are private rooms for people to actually receive the assessment and counseling. Once that's in order, start introducing and bringing together people and saying, okay, let's try it. Let's try and share. Let's learn from what we do and let's measure what we're learning. So these little funny circles are actually the core of what happens in improvement. You plan to do next, NACS, not next, but NACS. But what are you going to do next then among all these things that you're supposed to do? Let's try something. Let's measure it and let's see how well we've done. And I'll give you a couple of examples of the kind of solutions that clinics have come up with that have turned out to be quite groundbreaking. They seem simple, but it made life eminently easier for the healthcare providers, and it enabled them to do all those seven steps that are necessary for next, which are assessment, categorizing, what does assessment say, what nutritional status does the client have, counseling around the assessment, food, prescribed food, RUTF, or fortified blended food, if that's indicated, ensuring follow-up, both within the facility, but also follow-up with the clinic and making sure there is support systems there, so that we have good outcomes. Now, some of the nutritional experts say that you have to do all of this. Why break it up? If you break it up into steps, it's more manageable for somebody to start. It's pretty overwhelming when you get, you know, a tome like that that tells you all those details that are right behind the graph that Tim showed and go, my God, I have no idea where to start. So let's start with the first step and let's see if we can make the first step happen. That's how it went. Just one. Don't worry about the counseling yet. We'll come to that. We're not forgetting it, but let's figure out how to do the first step. We like data. So facilities and measures, how many of the clients that came every day actually were assessed. And they were pretty appalled at first because it was very low, zero. So they started measuring. Just by measuring, you start improving. And they started thinking about what they can do. And one of the examples, for instance, is the idea of the expert client. Now, I know the expert client is pretty broadly used right now. But in 2008 and 2009, that was a pretty novel idea. So expert clients became critically important for healthcare providers. They were taught how to do MUEX assessment, UX assessment, and how to write it down. The second step, categorization. How to figure out where to write it down when on the traditional HWA clinical record, it was nowhere to write nutritional assessment down because it was never done before. So where to write it down? Little slips of paper or, well, some of the provincial managers started advocating at the national level, and when the HIBA's medical record was being revised, they were able to get the new act, the next added to the record. So now all health facilities can actually and are reminded daily that they must do steps 1, 2, and 3. So we have data for all the different steps, and of course facilities are asked to integrate all those steps as they gain more experience. And they do gain more experience, and they get a lot of self-confidence from actually realizing that they can make something happen that seems pretty complicated. Seems simple, and it's in the simplicity really that is, you know, the beauty of the method, I would say. Producing RUTF, not that easy. It seems easy, but it turned out to take a lot of energy and work, both from the government side and from RACO, which was the local food producer who was selected competitively to become the partner in NuLife and USAID. It received a lot of support from us and from NutriSet, and it's actually continuing to get support, technical assistance from NutriSet well after NuLife is over. We received a patent licensure from NutriSet because the government decided that it wanted to use the plumping up formula and the plumping up formula is patented. So NutriSet stepped up up to that challenge, and they have really been a very good partner to RECO. and it also allowed the Uganda National Bureau of Standards to certify the products, which allowed it to go actually into the clinic. The last day of the project, the final conference of the project, Premier Secretary of the Ministry of Health announced that Rutshaka, which is how the project is called in Uganda, is being put on the essential drug list. That was a huge achievement. And why is that important? It is important because health facilities cannot order a supply or a drug, and Rutshaka is a medicine. It's not on the approved list from the government. So getting it on that list is a critically important step to get that, and it's actually official. It is now there. And finally, very important also, RECO became so enthralled with the whole process, it started looking at this as something bigger than just another commercial product that they were producing. And when it was confronted with the challenge to get quality raw materials, in particular quality groundnuts that were uncontaminated, it worked with the Ministry of Health and with NuLife, AID, to set up programs where either HIV-positive individuals who were still traditionally stable or people who had graduated from the program were offered plots of land to grow nuts with technical support and seeds from RECO. Northern Diocese in North Uganda in the Runa region heard about it and offered even more land, and RECO offered more technical support. So right now we have about 4,000 farmers who are producing groundnuts. They have a guaranteed market and, of course, guaranteed income, so that will help their families. Where does this leave us in terms of conclusions? Just a couple I wanted to say. This is a presentation about next in HIV/AIDS programming. And I want to link back to what both John and Tim said earlier. What I presented here should not necessarily be viewed as something that is limited only to HIV/AIDS programs. I think what it is, what it shows is that it is possible and helpful to break down complicated guidelines, complex guidelines, and I salute UNICEF for recognizing the complexity and the iteration of continuous updates which are necessary as new evidence comes forth. But it does pose challenges for governments and for healthcare providers, how to change all the time, and change is inherent in our life. I realize that, but it doesn't necessarily make it easier to follow. Measurement by the people themselves. Measurement is so important because it empowers people. It actually shows whether something that you're trying to do works or doesn't work. And if it doesn't work, it motivates very much to see if you can do it a little different. Because the next time you try it, maybe by tinkering with the process ever so little, you might have a breakthrough change. It's very motivating for people. We've seen it not just in HIV/AIDS improvement programs, but across the board in all improvements where it works. When people are able to make changes themselves in the orbit of the work over which they have control, it changes the dynamic, which is very important. But most of all, it provides evidence for what works. And the evidence is what nutrition programs need. They need it for HIV/AIDS, but they also need it as it is expanding and claiming its rightful place, if you will, among MSPH programs, among environmental health programs, and among multisectoral programs such as Feed the Future. So,
thank you. Lots there.